Here comes Mr. Oliver. Apart from being our scoutmaster, Mr. Oliver taught us maths, a subject in which I had some difficulty obtaining pass marks. Sometimes I scraped through, usually I got something like 20 or 30 out of 100. Failed again, Bond, Mr. Oliver would say. What will you do when you grow up? Become a scoutmaster, sir? Scoutmasters don't get paid. It's an honorary job. You could become a cook. That would suit you. He hadn't forgotten our scout camp when I had been the camp's cook. If Mr. Oliver was in a good mood, he'd give me grace marks, passing me by a mark or two. He wasn't a hard man, but he seldom smiled. He was very dark, thin, stooped. From a distance, he looked like a question mark and balding. He was about 40, still a bachelor, and it was said that he had been unlucky in love, that the girl he was going to marry jilted him at the last moment, running away with a sailor while Mr. Oliver waited at the church, ready for the wedding ceremony. No wonder he always had such a sorrowful look. Mr. Oliver did have one inseparable companion, a dachshund, a snappy little sausage of a dog, who looked upon the human race, and especially small boys, with a certain disdain and frequent hostility. We called him Hitler. This was 1945, and the dictator was at the end of his tether. He was impervious to our terse of friendship, and if you tried to pat or stroke him, he would do his best to bite your fingers or your skin or ankle. However, he was devoted to Mr. Oliver and followed him everywhere except into the classroom. This our headmaster would not allow. You remember that old nursery line? Mary had a little lamb, its fleece was white as snow. And everywhere that Mary went, the lamb was sure to go. Well, we made up our own version of the rhyme, and I must confess to having had a hand in its composition. It went like this. Ollie had a little dog, it was never out of sight. And everyone that Ollie met, the dog was sure to bite. It followed him about the school grounds. It followed him when he took a walk through the pines to the Broquist tennis court. It followed him into town and home again. Mr. Oliver had no other friend, no other companion. The dog slept at the foot of Mr. Oliver's bed. It did not sit at the breakfast table, but it had buttered toast for breakfast and soup and crackers for dinner. Mr. Oliver had to take his lunch in the dining hall with the staff and boys. But he had an arrangement with one of the bearers whereby a plate of dal, rice and chapatis made its way to Mr. Oliver's quarters and his well-fed pet. And then tragedy struck. Mr. Oliver and Hitler were returning to school after an evening walk through the pines. It was dusk and the light was fading fast. Out of the shadows of the trees emerged a lean and hungry panther. It pounced on the hapless dog, flung it across the road, seized it between its powerful jaws, and made off with its victim into the darkness of the forest. Mr. Oliver was untouched, but frozen into immobility for at least a minute. Then he began calling for help. Some bystanders who had witnessed the incident began shooting too. Mr. Oliver ran into the forest, but there was no sign of dog or panther. Mr. Oliver appeared to be a broken man. He went about his duties with a poker face, but we could all tell that he was grieving for his lost companion, for in the classroom he was listless and indifferent to whether or not we followed his calculations on the blackboard. In times of personal loss, the highest common factor made no sense. Mr. Oliver was no longer seen going on his evening walk. He stayed in his room, playing cards with himself. He played with his food, pushing more of it aside. There were no chapatis to send home. "Ollie needs another pet," said Bimal, wise in the ways of adults. "Or a wife," said Tata, who thought on those lines. "He's too old. He must be 40. Over 40. "A pet is best," I said. "What about a parrot?" "You can't take a parrot for a walk," said Bimal. "Ollie wants someone to walk beside him. A cat, maybe?" Hitler hated cats. A cat would be an insult to Hitler's memory. "Then he needs another dachshund, but there aren't any around here." "Any dog will do. We'll ask Chimpu to get us a pup." Chimpu ran the tuck shop. He lived in the Chota Shimla Bazaar, and occasionally we would ask him to bring up stops or marbles, a cornflake or other little things that we couldn't get in school. Five of us boys scouts contributed a rupee each, which we gave to Chimpu and asked him to get us a pup. A good breed, we told him, not a mongrel. The next evening, Chimpu turned up with a pup that seemed to be a combination of at least five different breeds, all good ones, no doubt. One ear lay flat, the other stood upright. It was spotted like a Dalmatian, but it had the legs of a spaniel and the tail of a Pomeranian. It was floppy and playful, and the tail wedged a lot, which was more than Hitler's ever did. "It's quite pretty," said Tata. "Must be a female." "He may not want a female," said Bimal. "Let's give it a try," I said. During our play hour, before the bell rang for supper, we left the pup on the steps outside Mr. Oliver's front door. Then we knocked and sped into the hibiscus bush that lined the pathway. Mr. Oliver opened the door. He looked down at the pup with an expressionless face. The pup began to paw at Mr. Oliver's shoes, loosening one of his laces in the process. "Away with you," muttered Mr. Oliver. "Buzz off." And he pushed the pup away, gently but firmly, and closed the door. We went through the same procedure again, but the result was much the same. We now had a playful pup on our hands, and Chimpu had gone home for the night. We would have to conceal it in the dormitory. At first, we hid it in Bimal's locker, but it began to yelp and struggle to get out. Tata took it into the shower room, but it wouldn't stay there either. It began running around the dormitory, playing with socks, shoes, slippers, and anything else it could get hold of. "Watch out," hissed one of the boys. "Here comes Fisher." Mrs. Fisher, the headmaster's wife, was on her nightly rounds, checking to make sure we were all in bed and not up to some natural mischief. I grabbed the pup and hid it under my blanket. It was quiet there, happy to nibble at my toes. When Mrs. Fisher had gone, I let the pup loose again, and for the rest of the night, it had the freedom of the dormitory. At the crack of dawn, before first light, Bimal and I sped out of the dormitory in our pajamas, taking the pup with us. We banged hard on Mr. Oliver's door and kept knocking until we heard footsteps approaching. As soon as the door was slowly opened, we pushed the pup inside and ran for our lives. Mr. Oliver came to class as usual, but there was no pup with him. 3 or 4 days passed and still no sign of the pup. Had he passed it on to someone else, or simply let it wander off on its own? "Here comes Oily," called Bimal, from our vantage point near the school bell. Mr. Oliver was setting out for his evening walk. He was carrying a strong walnut wood walking stick to keep panthers at bay, no doubt. He looked neither left nor right, and if he noticed us watching him, Mr. Oliver gave no sign. But then, scurrying behind him was the pup. The creature of many good breeds was accompanying Mr. Oliver on his walk. It had been well brushed and was wearing a bright red collar. Like Mr. Oliver, it took no notice of us. It walked along beside its new master. Mr. Oliver and the little pup were soon inseparable companions, and my friends and I were quite pleased with ourselves. Mr. Oliver gave absolutely no indication that he knew where the pup had come from, but when the end of term exams were over, and Bimal and I were sure that we had failed our maths paper, we were surprised to find that we had passed after all, with grace marks. Good old Oily, said Bimal. So he knew all the time. Tata, of course, did not need grace marks. He was a wizard at maths. But Bimal and I decided we would thank Mr. Oliver for his kindness. Nothing to thank me for, said Mr. Oliver gruffly, but with a twist at the corners of his mouth, which was the nearest he came to a smile. I have seen enough of you two in junior school. It's high time you went up to the senior school, and God help you there.